I am.
Y'all did? All right.
Y'all be got it.
Arterial blood pressure, central venous pressure, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, systemic vascular resistance, cardiac output, cardiac index, and SCVO2. We're gonna touch briefly on pharmacologic therapy, and then we'll talk about, as we go, nursing care. This book is the book for this lecture, chapter 5. Okay? Be sure to read it.
Mm-hmm.
There's also an article that's been posted on Canvas. I don't know if you looked at it yet, but this is Bedside Clinician's Guide to Pulmonary Artery Catheters. This is a helpful resource, and we'll touch in this lecture, some things in this article. Okay, and also I posted late last night on Canvas a diagram of the heart, which I think is beneficial to look at as you begin to study and look through the heart and review the chapter. It's helpful to see where the valves are, the right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, and left ventricle. With all that being said, we'll get started. Okay, there's different types of hemodynamic monitoring. We're gonna look at the non-invasive and the invasive. So non-invasively, you're not doing anything, you're assessing the patient, basically. You don't have any lines in the patient. You're looking at their mental status. Are they awake? Are they alert? Are they oriented when you enter the room? Are they lethargic? Are they drowsy? You can look at their blood pressure. What is it? Is it high? Is it low? You're going to look at the heart rate. Are they tachy? Are they tachycardic? Do they have a normal heart rate? Look at the pulse. Are they bounding? Are they weak? Skin temperature? Are they warm and dry? Are they cool and clammy? What's the capillary refill? Is it less than 3 seconds? Is it more than 3 seconds? Pulse oximetry gives you an idea of their oxygenation and their urine output. What are they doing every hour? And in ICU, of course, you'll be looking at this every hour. Passive leg raises. There's a video that's posted on Canvas for you to look at. But I'll touch briefly on this. It's a simple and a reliable technique. Doing this is simple, it's reliable. You can use it to prevent fluid overload in critically ill patients. IV administration is normally what's given in critically ill patients. But it's crucial to try to avoid overhydrating that patient and putting them in pulmonary edema, or underhydrating them and have them go into kidney failure. So, what happens with the passive leg raise is that you can raise the head of the bed to 45 degrees, and this is done in the critically ill patients, mechanically ill patients. Raise the head to 45 degrees for 5 minutes. Then you're going to lower the upper bed to supine, but the bottom of the bed, you're going to elevate not the feet, but you're going to elevate the actual bed up. And when you're looking at the cardiac monitor, if the cardiac output increases, then you have a positive response without giving any type of hydration. You're not hydrating the patient, you're just doing the test.
I looked at your video. Is it patient flat, feet up at 45 degree angle, or is it head bed up at 45 degree angle? Because I might be confused.
The bed itself, the bottom of the bed.
The bottom of the bed goes up at 45.
You're not picking their legs up. You'll see it on the video.
So it's not the head of the bed, it's the bottom of the bed.
Right.
So it looks like this. Patient's head is right here, flat, and then the bottom of the bed, you said, goes up like that?
Okay.
I've been explaining it wrong for a lot of time. There you go. That's okay. So where's the head of the bed?
Here.
There you go. Okay. You with me? Lay the patient flat, put their feet up in 45 degrees. They're going to get a fluid bolus from their venous, from their legs.
Right. Without having a seat, you don't want to overhydrate them, so you don't want to keep giving fluids if you don't need to. Then you'll see if they are adequately hydrated, you're going to see their cardiac output go up, and we'll talk more about that without ever having to give fluids. So this is an easy, reliable test to do without actually even hanging fluids yet to see if they respond.
Ms. Hazel, on the bed, is it an option to, so you know how on the bed it'll say Trendelenburger, or it's another one where they're sitting up in the chair, is it an option to click for that, or do you physically put the leg of the bed part up 45?
You put in the actual leg, the not kicking their feet up.
Yeah, no, no,
the
bed itself.
The bed should go up a
you
little
would,
bit.
I adjust it to that. Okay. Yes.
I got a question. So you perform this test, like if it's positive, like how long would it be before it's positive? Like how much time would you give the patient to see if it's positive?
It's going to show while you're looking at the monitor, you'll see the cardiac output.
Okay. Immediately. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So instead of giving fluid after fluid, you can do this test. They may not need fluids.
Okay.
Ms. Pesos,
What
I learned from Dr. Udo, even when a patient doesn't have a fancy swan dance catheter and is on the monitor, you're on MedSurg, you're on step down tele, you don't have this fancy stuff, your patient hits the call button, I feel lightheaded, you go in, you take their systolic, they're a little cold and clammy, it's low, you lay them flat, you put their feet up, a few minutes later, you check their blood pressure, that systolic went up. You call that doc, share that information, the doc may order fluid, say, this patient's a fluid responder, let's order some fluid.
Yes.
So those passive leg raises are the bomb. It's like, wow.
On the invasive side, of course, you have your arterial line, your central line, with the central venous pressure, your CVP. by the systolic breath, blood pressure, normal shock index is 0.5 to 0.7. The shock index is known as hemodynamic stability. They have a pumping heart, they have adequate blood volume, and good circulation. But in cases of trauma, it's commonly used to assess the amount of blood loss, the degree of hypovolemic shock, and it can be used for any patient. So if you're in the ER and you see a patient come in, that's hemorrhaging, the shock index greater than 0.9 is found to predict the increased risk of mortality. If you take the systolic blood pressure of 120, for example, divided by a heart rate of 111, it is 0.9. And if it's greater than 0.9, they found that there are some profound poor outcomes in the patient. So it's an easy thing to assess the minute that they hit the door. A quick prediction. Okay, we're going to talk about concepts and basic hemodynamics. Blood pressure, simply. Systolic pressure is the peak pressure. Diastolic pressure is the lowest point of the pressure. The pulse pressure is the difference between the systolic and the diastolic pressure. Mean arterial pressure, or the MAP, of course you've been working with this for a while now. The average pressure of one cardiac cycle, it is a better indicator of overall perfusion than systolic pressure. And the MAP greater than 60 millimeters of mercury indicates adequate perfusion.
So our normal value for MAP is 70 to
100,
right?
Yeah, so in your textbook, what is that? 70 to 100.
So greater than 70.
70 to 105. To 105 millimeters of mercury. The formula. Systolic blood pressure plus 2 times the diastolic blood pressure divided by 3. Hemodynamic calculations. You have to know these not necessarily the how to get it, but what the normal values are, because you have to know what normal is so that you can know what abnormal is. So the mean arterial pressure, these are in your book on chapter 5, page 120. 70 to 105 millimeters of mercury, mean arterial pressure, the cardiac output, 4 to 8 liters per minute, cardiac index, 2.8 to 4.2 liters per minute squared. The stroke volume, 60 to 100 milliliters per minute. Systemic vascular resistance, 900 to 1400 dynes. And peripheral vascular resistance, 100 to 250 dynes. And we're going to talk a little bit about central venous oxygen saturation, or the SCVO2, 70 to 80%. Cardiac output. The volume of blood ejected by the left ventricle every minute. Normal cardiac output is 4 to 8 liters per minute. As we just said, cardiac output is heart rate times stroke volume. cardiac index is cardiac output divided by body surface area. Most of the bedside monitors automatically calculate the cardiac index once the height and weight are entered. To further define cardiac output, is stroke volume times heart rate. And stroke volume consists of preload, contractility, and afterload. So what is preload? It's the volume of blood that's received by the heart. It's the stretch on the ventricular myocardium at the end of diastole. Afterload is the pressure or the resistance the heart has to overcome to eject blood. I think of it like a basketball. You're trying to eject the blood out. You're trying to get it out. Afterload is the squeeze also. So preload is the volume of blood in the ventricles at the end of diastole. It's also known as the filling pressures, end diastolic pressure. And as I said, afterload is the resistance the left ventricles must overcome to circulate the blood. Preload, we talked about as the stretch. Of the myocardium at the end of diastole. Those who have trauma or a GI bleed, what do you think is going to happen to the preload?
Decrease.
It's going to go down. Those who have atrial fib, what do you think about the preload? What's going to happen?
It's going to go
down. It's going to go down. Okay. Here's the heart. Right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle. You also have preload in the right ventricle, and you have preload to the left ventricle. So let's take this a little further. Right side of the heart, left side of the heart. Preload, we talked about when it's down, now I'll say when it's elevated on the right side and the left side, you can see volume in cases of volume overload. Tricuspid stenosis. You know why?
Because it came down.
Right, because there's a tricuspid valve. Okay, you have a diatribe, right ventricle. Blood has to travel from here over through the tricuspid valve to the right ventricle. What is stenosis?
Narrowing.
So if you have your vessel and you have a narrowing, or it can even be blocked. So what do you think this is going to do to the preload? It's going to back up here. And there's your volume of the load. Okay. What about pulmonary stenosis? And this is what I was telling you, your picture of your heart. Okay. Now we're looking at pulmonary stenosis, the pulmonary valve. What happens when that becomes stenotic?
To back up into the right ventricle.
Exactly. Causing elevated preload. What about pulmonary hypertension? What do you think? You got all this fluid backing up. Your preload is going to be elevated. What about this? What if you have a right ventricle infarct? What do you think? Muscle damage, tissue damage right here. Elevated preload. Okay. You got any questions? You can see as you study this, look at the picture of the heart. The diagram helps to tell you everything. Okay. Now that we looked at the right heart, let's look at the left side. Can you all see this on this slide?
Yeah.
So let's look at the left side of the heart. Too much volume. Basically the same thing. Volume of the load. It's going to elevate the preload on the left side of the heart. What if you have mitral stenosis? What's going on with this? Mitral valve, stenotic, could even be blocked. Where's the blood going to go? It's not even a place to go, so left side of the preload. Any questions? Okay. Thank you. How are we gonna look? Let's look at afterload. What did we say afterload was? Resistance. Right? It's gotta take to eject that blood out. Right? It's gotta go forward, it's gotta get out. So there's our heart, right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle. Something called right vascular resistance. Okay. Right vascular resistance.
Is that the same as pulmonic vascular resistance?
Exactly. Which I was just about to say. It's the same as pulmonary vascular resistance. That's right. Also known as PVR. Okay. What do you say, PVR? 100 to 250 dimes, and that's in the book. So think about this. When do you think this is going to be elevated? After load is going to be elevated. One clue. Pulmonary.
Pulmonary stenosis. Pulmonary stenosis.
Pulmonary stenosis. I'm writing that wrong. Pulmonary stenosis. Pulmonary valve, right here. Blood's trying to get out. If it's narrow, if it's blocked, it's not gonna work so well. Okay. What else? In the event of a pulmonary embolism. Pulmonary vascular resistance. What else? We mentioned it before. Pulmonary hypertension. And in cases of hypoxia. We're going to look at the right side of the heart. Are y'all understanding it? Okay, so let's see this. All right, we have afterload. So left ventricular resistance is also known as systemic. Vascular resistance.
Ms. Pacers,
uh-huh.
Did you transpose the left and the right?
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. Because I'm 63. Yeah. I need all the help I can get through this.
Sorry.
Okay. There we go. We're good. We're good.
You got it? Okay, so left ventricle, here we go. I'm gonna have my coffee.
Nah.
Vascular resistance, okay? So when do you think this is elevated? The right ventricle. And hypertension.
Wait, I thought you said we were on the right side of the heart.
You may have heard of left ventricular hypertrophy. It's part of its behavior. Usually induces excessive hypertension. What about this? What about aortic stenosis? Two more cases. In hypothermia, and in vasopressor use. So these are all elevated. In cases mainly of shock, septic shock, anaphylactic shock, and neurogenic shock, which we'll cover in mobility. Decreased afterload. We're seeing cases of shock, septic shock, anaphylactic shock, and neurogenic shock, which I was saying we'll discuss more in mobility. Does that make sense? I'm using the diagram to get kind of.
Can I say one thing that helps me?
Uh-huh.
When you're septic, those vessels dilate, and they're wide, and there's no resistance. Your SVR drops. So they're the ones that get, and their blood pressure's down in the toilet. They're going to need volume, then they're going to need pressors, possibly. And resistance is so low. You got to build it up.
Okay.
When they're studying and they're rolling off to sleep, they'll be like,
whoa. Okay. All right, contractility. The ability of the myocardium to shorten the muscle fibers is influenced by electrolytes, mainly potassium and calcium, acid-base abnormalities, myocardial oxygen supply demand abnormalities. With decreased contractility, patients with hyperkalemia, hypocalcemia, myocardial ischemia, hypercapnia, hypoxia, acidosis, and the administration of negative inotropic medications. And negative inotropes being your beta blockers. Calcium channel blockers. Okay. You'll have increased contractility patients with hypercalcemia and the administration of positive inotropic medications. Those can be dopamine, dobutamine, norepinephrine, digoxin. Central venous oxygen saturation, or SCVO2. Percentage of oxygen-bound hemoglobin in blood returning to the right side of the heart. It's measuring oxygen supply and demand in the body. So by the time, I'm thinking of, tell me that this correctly, from starting with the heart, by the time the blood travels all around, the consumption that you've already used of your oxygen is at approximately 25%?
Exactly.
And so, and that the normal range already is 25 to 30% by the time it travels from the right side of the heart all the way back to the heart. So that leaves approximately 70% available that's left.
70% SC, it's your venous oxygen. And you know what, forever I didn't understand this, and Dr. Udo enlightened me. There was a little paragraph in an article, an old article, and it said this, just like Ms. Pezo said, you know, we start off 100% and then we're on the delivery truck and we're delivering oxygen to all the tissues that need it. By the time you get back to the superior vena cava, 70 to 80% would be woo-hoo, rock and rolling. Well, what if it's 50 or 55%? Honey, something must have happened along the way. Maybe the patient's septic, maybe they were febrile, maybe they had seizures, which ate more oxygen up along the way. That always helped me.
in ICU, of course, all this, it's usually measured in the superior vena cava, the right atrium, through a central venous catheter. Let's see, and it can be measured continuously by using a specialized central venous catheter.
Like a special, an SCVO2 Swan? My Swan vein catheters are just plain. They're just a regular PA catheter. But there's fancy ones that they use at Ochsner Kenner, the SCVO2 Swans.
Yeah, there's a sensor.
Yes.
That sensor. So yes. It'll tell you the SCVO2.
Exactly.
I mean, I don't, you know, we're just going to learn that much about it, but, you know, that it's available, that it, you can actually sense it through the central venous catheter. There's a sensor that has a reading. Okay, you know, normal is 70 to 80. So you want to kind of target that. And as I read, if you get, you don't want to get to 90 because you may be over-perfusing.
Yeah, God, I've never even heard of that.
Yeah, it said, I read something about that. I'm not very familiar with this technique, so we're just going to, you know, have the basics on.
Don't put it on the test.
Throw it out.
Wait, what she said?
It's the first question.
Yeah.
I'm kidding.
I'm not taking it.
No, so I've got to be able to communicate this.
No, you're doing fantastic. I'm learning a lot. No, seriously.
I'm not the ICU.
Sure
not. So trying to understand. All right, so medications. We just talked about preload, afterload. All right, in cases where you want to decrease the preload. You have diuretics available, furosemide, eumetanide, Umex, or low-dose dopamine. In cases where you want to decrease the afterload, vasodilators, nitride, trivial.
And this bezos, we were talking about this yesterday when we had a patient with dopamine that was turned off. But dopamine in 2 to 5 mics per kilogram per minute, it's just pure renal dilatation. That's all it is. That's old school. I learned that when I was a new nurse.
To increase afterload, the vasopressors, epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, vasopressin. And we talked a little bit about this with decreased contractility, calcium channel blockers, increasing contractility with dobutamine, dopamine, norepinephrine, and digoxin. We'll talk a little bit about these pressure monitoring systems and then we'll take that. All right. So the basic components of any invasive hemodynamic pressure monitoring system, the flush system, the transducer, and the monitor. You have your pressure bag when you have your access site with this non-compressible tubing connected to the transducer and an automatic flush system, and the electrical activity from those transducers transferred to the monitor to be read. This is a little bit on zeroing and leveling. You have your transducer. They have one line, the CVP, or you got art line, the CVP, and the PA catheter. You're going to find your fourth intercostal space. And midway between the outermost anterior chest and the outermost posterior chest, you measure from this side. Okay, I wanted to show you the transducers connected to this. We're going to watch a video. In a little while. The square wing monitoring test allows the nurse to test the ability of the pressure monitoring system to accurately reflect pressure values. You can activate the fast flush here, this yellow device, on the fast flush system and observe the monitor for the pressure waveform.
Ms. Pazos, the one, the setup that my four groups thus far have seen clinical, it doesn't have that little yellow pigtail to pull. It's got two little white plastic things that you squeeze. You just squeeze them and then it makes it flush. So you didn't see that little yellow guy. You saw the two white things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this one, and I did see some of that on, are these still, these are still available?
I have. They might be, but they're not at EJ. Okay. I can only tell you that we're probably buying the cheap version. Okay. It was on sale.
We saw them. They weren't yellow. They were different color. But
yeah,
they were
seen
cool.
Some are blue and whatever other color, depending on the manufacturer, I would imagine. So you perform the square wave test on the initial setup on every shift after opening the system and when the values are suspected to be inaccurate. And this is the waveform described as a sharp upstroke, a plateau, and then a rapid downstroke. This extends below the baseline, followed by one or two smaller waveforms, lasting 1.12 seconds. Arterial pressure monitoring, when do we use it? When the blood pressure needs to be continuously monitored, if you have a hemodynamically unstable patient, if you're receiving vasopressors or vasodilators, or you can sample it for arterial blood gas analysis. On that note, we'll take a 10-minute break and then we'll come